Okay, blessings of the Holy Spirit to everyone. It's the Holy Spirit that informs us in many diverse ways, actually. The grace of God is able to clarify for us. And there's no limit to how the grace of God can do this. Grace of God is formless in itself, but it can work through form. So I have been informed and helped in various ways. And this is ongoing awakening. Part of this awakening is to recognize the great deception that is coming in this world. And I'm going through this recognition, and it's just, wow, I'm telling you, it's just wow, a very, very strong wow. And I'd say, you know, it's good to sidestep the times that are to come, because the deception in the world is going to be extraordinary. In the Bible, they say that it's capable of even leading the elect of God astray. Yeah, this is true. This is true. I'm seeing what is in store. And I know I'm having a good idea now of what's in store actually for us. Appearances of false Christs, false Jesuses is what's in store for us. To be surrounded by apostles who, I call them, those are the facade of respectability, hiding the actors that are playing Jesus. And these apostles will be genuinely honest and very, very knowledgeable spiritual people. But they're being blackmailed, actually, subtly blackmailed, spiritually blackmailed. And so they run interference for this actor. Jesus will be portrayed by an actor. And these apostles will be the ones who do the miracles and all the wonders and such. And so then people will think that these are ascribed to this Jesus figure. And these Jesus figure are plural, could be plural, a number of actors around the world, explained by location. But it'll be different actors. These actors will then lead, there's a whole plan to lead the world astray into a false ideology, a merit-based ideology, a gradualist ideology, a definitional-based belief system, a body-based belief system. All this is set up. But who set it up? We did. Our psyche, the mind. The mind is paranoid. When it tried to be greater than God, it went into this massive paranoia about that the mind will be annihilated if it stops this effort of definition, because it believes that God is definable. When it stops trying to define God, it thinks that then God will have disappeared, vanished, and that thus mind will disappear and vanish. So it creates this inherent massive paranoia, massive dread and fear, and then this is defended against. So the mind, all of this world is theater, actually. It's all theater. And the mind has designed this grand theater for these times, which will distract everybody in this world and from what I call the reptilian takeover of this planet. But through this distraction, they will be led into accepting this takeover, like, oh, this is the New World Order, this is the millennium, etc. It's amazing the deception that is to come here. And the Bible points this out very clearly. There's this grand, grand deception that is going to take place. So this is, Holy Spirit has given us a heads up on this. And the great Yogini, Dakini, Chandra Sering children actually pointed this out to me and helped awaken my consciousness to this. It's amazing. You might call her, you know, doing an act of saving the world in a certain way is helping bring this grand deception to light, is an extraordinarily helpful activity. And she catalyzed that, was sent by Jamyang Yensi Choki Lodro, who is a very close associate, spiritual associate of Longchenpa. Very close. They all work as one, and they certainly are aware of what is coming and the grand deception. And it largely stems around Jesus and having fake Jesuses. I think there's a movie called He Is Risen, and it's an actor playing Jesus, and it's very, very, very realistic, at least in people's minds. It's not in my mind, you see, but many will look and say, oh my God, that is Jesus. You know, so there are these actors that are being trained actually to play Jesus, but the yoga girls act, they have a very strong role to play in it too. The apostles who will be around Jesus are being blackmailed, spiritually blackmailed, but also they think that they're here to help the world, and they hope maybe this is Jesus. Maybe it is. They want to believe so badly, and they want to help the world so badly, and that they. But the yoga girls are there to, you know, as a seductive aspect of the situation, no question about it. I can go on and on and about this of how it's going to play out, but it's going to be grand theater coming up very soon. I think this year, probably. This spring, this summer, and I've been put under massive pressure to be one of the apostles, and that's why I'm outing the whole thing. It's blackmail. It's plain and simple blackmail. If you really look at it, you know this isn't the real Jesus, but you feel that you want. Is also subtle karmas involved too, like the desire to be famous, the desire to have a great influence upon the world, all this kind of stuff. Because this grand theater is going to be the movie industry is going to film this actually, and the television stations are going to cover it all over the world, and they're going to be massive media coverage of this fake Jesus situation. And the apostles are going to be the ones who smooth out all the rough edges, and this Jesus, fake Jesus actor is going to, of course, mess up in a lot of different ways. The apostles are there to smooth everything over and say, don't worry, this is all okay, everything's working out just fine, we can explain it to you. So they're very good apologists, you might say. They might be supremely expert apologists, very spiritually knowledgeable, can speak in any spiritual direction, which I can certainly do. I would make like a perfect apostle of this situation, but I'm saying no to that and outing the whole situation for those who will listen. Very few will listen though, actually, because their desire to believe is so strong that they will be, the world will be easily misled by this, actually. And the actor Jesus may just say a few lines, mostly keep quiet and you know, be very humble. He will appear among the homeless and will be helping them with their ministry, but it's actually the apostles will be doing the great miracles and the great work, because they have genuine spiritual grace flowing through them, except they are still not quite liberated, okay? And they have this, so they still have, they're willing to fudge it a little bit here, you know? They say, well, at least I'm helping out, this is going to be overall helpful for the world. And so they're able to justify it in their mind. You have to have mercy and compassion on them, because they're headed down a suicidal path, actually. At some point, the enormity of what they've done will dawn upon them. So, let's already forgive them for what they are about to do. And I can certainly relate to them in their desire to be helpful and spread the truth. And they think this is an opportunity, because all the media is there, all the attention, worldwide attention. They feel that they can start showing miracles and show this stuff. But the problem is all these miracles will be ascribed to this fake Jesus, and this fake Jesus will be aligned with the yoga girls and the goddess and the new world order, actually. And the message they're giving out is actually a dualistic, body-based, definition-based, false teaching. This is not the real Jesus. And yet this is exactly what the world wants. See, this is why it will be so powerful and effective. This is what the world wants. The world wants, it's very interesting, it's actually very difficult to keep believing in incarnation in bodies. It's not natural at all. Reincarnation is not some law of God. It's not natural at all. It's a ferociously arrogant attempt on our part to keep this definitional game going. So we have a very difficult time keeping it going, actually. So we always feel we're being drawn back to truth, which we feel misinterpret. We feel is an abyss of annihilation. So we're under ferocious fear to keep this bodies, incarnation of bodies, producing bodies. So the yoga girls are there to sex up the whole thing, really. To get everyone's attention on, you know, that Jesus is back bodily. You know, we're supposed to love one another, both physically and spiritually. It's all one, and they want to keep this whole thing about producing bodies going, You know, this is what paranoids think is essential to protect them from a complete abyss like annihilation. And the world, the truth is, most of the world worships the god of absurdity, an absurdist god, not the true god. Jehovah's an absurdist god. It's not the true god. And Jesus came to bring this truth. I said, hey, this, you're not really, I bring a New Testament. And most people, including a lot of Christians, are still worshiping this god of absurdity, which is just an idol of our own making, actually. It's not true god at all. And so all the psychology is in play. It's tremendously potent psychology based on this very virulent paranoia that absurdism brings with us, the other side of a coin of absurdism. So there may be various venues around the world, okay, various venues where Jesus will apparently appear, and apostles will gather around Jesus. And again, the people say, well, how is this possible? Jesus can appear in many places at once. And the apostles, the New Age apostles, will explain this. People say, well, by location, you see. Now, I've explained by location, and it's very true. But this is not actually what's happening. You see, so this is a very tricky thing, right? This is why these apostles can be apologists for it. They run interference by saying, giving a genuine spiritual explanation for what's happening, except this is not actually what's happening, but they want to believe it is. You know, they want so badly to help everyone. It's understandable, right? But keep in mind, the help that this world wants is the help in continuing this dream of reincarnation. Dream of bodies. That's what the help is. They think that's protecting them from annihilation. So they think that by helping this Jesus, false Jesus return, that everyone is being helped. This is what the powerful attraction of thinking, well, everyone's responding to this like, oh, thank God you're helping us out so much, you know. And there'll be many miracles, but it's the apostles doing the miracles of healing, all sorts of miracles. And people will think this is it. But the Bible warns us of this. There'll be many false Jesus will do many signs and wonders and miracles of all sorts of kinds. Yeah, this is true. This is what is coming. And the Dakini actually alerted me to all this. The Dakinis are this type of like angel, like we would say, Christians say angels, who inspire us upon the true spiritual path and warn us and protect us from, you know, falsity. They don't have so much of a didactic sort of teaching role. Those are the masters, the gurus, the teachers, the saviors, the sages, etc. The Dakinis, they can just appear somewhere in like an angel appearing, giving a message or giving the inspiration, and then they disappear. They're gone. But they help. In this case, it triggered a great, great, great realization. And then I went back and I saw there was relics left there on the site, and I couldn't quite interpret them at first. And now finally today I did, and I said, wow, it's a warning for this great deception that is coming, and the attempt to enlist me in that deception. And I'm aware of what the attempt is. I'm now, you know, consciously aware of it. And there's very strong karmic type of, you know, attention patterns trying to put me into a certain role at a certain place at a certain time, a certain role, and to play a powerful role in helping all this take place. So I was like, wow. The self-deception is extraordinary. The theater that the mind conjures up is just, you know, it's so extraordinary we can hardly believe it, really, how it orchestrates everything like a theater play, like it's scripted. Yeah, well, my role, it was to go down to Santa Monica and be like a homeless person down there, and begin evangelizing the homeless people down there. And that the plan is that Jesus, one of these, an actor Jesus, false Jesus, will show up in Santa Monica among the homeless and start doing this great ministry there. Santa Monica has one of the worst homeless problems in the world. Adjusting the lighting here. Because you can live outdoors there all year long, because the weather is so extraordinary in Santa Monica. that, you know, it doesn't get too hot and it doesn't get too cold. So there's a massive amount of homeless people there. And the idea is that these apostles will end up being homeless in Santa Monica. And then they will start ministering to these homeless people, trying to get the lighting back again. And they will be doing all these miracles and giving these talks and having the meditations but the homeless people that they cure of miracles, those are actually fake. Those are actually apostles themselves. You see, there's a group of apostles will be posing as homeless people there, and they will be cured of all sorts of stuff. And they see the light and they say, "Oh my gosh, you know, Jesus is coming, everyone. We know it's going to happen." And they will start this. There'll be a huge buzz in the community. The media will pick up on it, that there's some amazing grace flowing through the homeless community. And this will catch the imagination of the world. It'll be broadcast on television. And then at some point, this actor, Jesus, will show up. And the apostles and all the homeless people will congregate around Jesus. And they'll begin to have big crowds drawn on the beach in Santa Monica, actually, is what it's planned for. This will be broadcast. There'll be a film filmed about all this stuff happening. This film will be released in theaters around the world very quickly on YouTube. And there'll be this enormous worldwide buzz that Jesus is back and he's healing all the homeless people. He's ministering to all the homeless people. He's doing all these good works. The Pope will probably recognize this and say, you know, this is Jesus. Because look how he's helping the homeless people. This is what Jesus would do, right? But really, all the great eloquence and everything that's being done is being done by these apostles, actually. And the actor playing Jesus actually doesn't have the charisma to do this stuff. But he will play this role of "I'm above it all" kind of thing. And he might wash the feet and do certain things like that. The apostles will help him out with all this kind of stuff. So, yeah, you need to do this. Gotta look good. Help you look good, you know. Help you look good. Ultimately, what's going to happen is there's going to be enormous crowds come to the Santa Monica, Los Angeles area from around the world. And Jesus will, and the apostles will be walking along the beach. It's about a 10-mile beach from Pacific Palisades down to, past Venice Beach, down as far as it goes, about 10-mile beach, and very wide, enormous beach. And there's a boardwalk also goes on there. So this area is capable of holding multiple millions of people, actually. Okay, massive crowds. 10 million people, I don't know, just the 10-mile stretch, this whole stretch is capable of holding an enormous audience of people. And the fake Jesus and the apostles will be walking along this beach, back and forth, the 10-mile beach, blessing everyone. People will come from all over the world to be blessed by this. And it'll become just this enormous worldwide phenomena, actually. It's all set up. It's all set up. It's planned to be filmed. The Illuminati are in on this. And it's a false return of Jesus to mislead the world. But what will happen is this beach culture and this area is the number one area in the world of obsession with the body and the beautiful body. Santa Monica embodies that, actually. There's an extraordinary number of yoga girls there in yoga studios where the women are fanatically obsessed with how they look and their physicality, etc. There's Muscle Beaches, of course, in Venice, California. The men also are obsessed with it. So it's this extreme body culture. And as the world comes to this area, they will pick up this body culture vibe and they'll blend it together with sort of this false bliss. And this will become like the origins of the New World religion, actually. And then these yoga girls will go off. There'll be also this huge group of yoga girls who will be worshipers, adorers of Jesus, the false Jesus. And they will be, you know, but they're also very sort of erotic also. And so this will sort of create this false bliss buzz that's going on. And these yoga girls will spread throughout the world and start these temples throughout the world. They were blessed by Jesus and given this transmission by this fake Jesus. So this fake Jesus will be giving these transmissions, like Shaktipat, to these yoga girls and to many. And then they will go around. People will think that they have been blessed by Jesus and they're New Age apostles of the New Age religion. This is what's actually going to happen. This is what's planned to happen. Now, whether it will actually happen or not, we will see. But this is what's planned to happen. Santa Monica is one of the key spots. LAX's airport is very close to there. And this will enable massive, massive spiritual tourism to come into the area. And of course, Hollywood is there, and they will film this to unbelievable extent and make it look absolutely gorgeous and real. And they'll put in digital effects, special effects, various things to make it seem more realistic. Okay, it's actually a huge outdoor movie set is planned for this whole thing. And there's a lot of actresses and actors involved, but there will be some genuine, very advanced spiritual apostles who are doing all the miracles and the blessings and everything to make it look good, make it all look like it's legit, because they themselves have been under this blackmail. To do this, they've been pressured into it. There's no question about it. I've seen my whole life has been an attempt to pressure me into this, you know, and I've been investigating it. This is like the biggest conspiracy ever, and we're bringing to light this massive cosmic conspiracy for a fake return of Jesus, to fake the whole thing and yet present it through the media of the planet, and it will mislead. It'll be so realistic that it'll mislead. As Jesus said, it'll mislead even the elect of God. Will be misled by it. It's certainly capable of misleading them. And I understand that this is true. This is really true, that because there will be many, many, many healings and miracles and wonders done by these apostles, and then they will attribute it to this Jesus, and then the Jesus will give these blessings to the crowds, and then all these people who are already in place, their role is to then evangelize this new world religion and set up these many, many temples to the goddess, actually, which is designed to get us to refocus on physicality, on the body, and the supposed integration of spirit and body as one expression, and to keep this game of definition, keep this dream of definition going. The mind is completely obsessed with keeping this dream of definition going. It's paranoiacally obsessed with it, okay? So it is willing to stage all this stuff. It is very focused on staging all this. And, you know, Hollywood's the land of fakery, isn't it? It absolutely is. That whole area is. And so for them, it's just like, you know, yeah, this is just a great fakery. And they think that, for them, this is like the ultimate. Wow, look how talented we are. Look how we can even fake this. How wonderful. And they're in cahoots with, you know, the New World Order, the Illuminati, and the Draco reptilians, and all of this. So the Dracos will take over the world, and everybody will think, oh, everything's fine. You know, the New World religion that they want will already be in place without them doing anything. It's amazing how clever the mind is. It really is. That of self-deception, our creativity. But it's just like a play that's being scripted. Look at it that way. We're just putting on a play. So we can write the script any way we want to. So it's really not that clever, if you think about it. Just a playwright. Imagine a playwright writing this play, and then actors and actresses are acting out the play. And of course, we think that this is what everybody wants. See, this is what I've realized, that people, when they beg for help, they're really begging for help to keep defining what they are, keep this dream of definition going. That's what they're actually begging for. So if you're an apostle, a very advanced spiritual apostle, and you haven't uncovered this, you will think that you're helping people, because they react like, oh, your Savior is here. You're saving us. This is wonderful. And they will psychosomatically seem to get well from all sorts of illnesses, because the stress relief will be massive. Say, oh good, we're able to keep this dream going. And it's really designed to protect them from the genuine Jesus, the return of the genuine Jesus, which is inviting us to the reduced intensity zone, a reduced intensity zone where we can work on letting go of all definition of what we are. That's what the real Jesus is about. And they feel that's the devil inviting them to annihilation. So they think that this fake Jesus is saving them from the devil. This is, they have it upside down and backwards. Most of the world is diluted in this way. Even you can be very spiritually advanced and still be diluted. Have not really seen this yet. And so you can easily be seduced and blackmailed into playing the role of an apostle, thinking that you're doing a great job and that maybe this is the real Jesus. Or if it's an actor, it's being done for a positive reason or something. You can justify it in your mind. Literally, our mind is under the impression that to be without definition is to be annihilated. Or actually, it's to be perfectly safe and sane and peaceful and truly blissful. Because it's abidance, abiding in abidance. It's abidance in abidance is our true nature. God in God. God being God. And everything is that. Everything is that. So, but this deep, deep dread of continuity, fear, and the abyss causes the mind to devise all of these strategies to deceive, mislead the world. So it doesn't really matter what I say. People will still be misled. You know, it just goes right over their head. They don't understand. But, you know, heads up is important. I have to talk about this because certainly there's this very strong effort to get me down there to Santa Monica. And it's amazing. It's also rated the most stressful city in America. It would run the Bloomberg grant to study why are people so unhappy and stressed out in American cities. Santa Monica, the people were rated as the number one or two most unhappy, stressed out people in America, with the most massive homeless problem, you know, super high rent, super gridlock in the streets, no cheap shopping areas at all. They're just stressed out to the max. So it's a perfect venue for this fake Jesus to arrive, and the people will welcome it with open arms, say, oh, you know, this is relieving our stress. You know, this is a great diversion from our stress. It'll pump massive amount of money into the economy. People will be subletting their apartments to tourists and people coming in, making a massive amount of money. So economically, it will be like a gold mine for them. And it will temporarily reduce their stress because it'll give them a distraction from their lives. And there'll be this, you know, daily meeting on the beach and blessing on the beach. And again, millions will come. Millions and millions and millions will come because the area can handle that. That's used to a massive influx of people to the beach, Santa Monica area. It's very used to that. That happens all throughout, from Memorial Day, or was it Labor Day, Memorial Day, whatever, through that area, that time. So, and the powers that be, you know, will become a phenomena, a worldwide, you know how fast Facebook and social media spreads phenomena. They will start spreading it on Facebook and Twitter and all this stuff about there's this incredible amount of healing and evangelization taking place. Of these very, very powerful, erudite, homeless people. What's going on? You know, the buzz. There'll be a huge buzz starting. And ultimately then they'll say, well, it's because Jesus is coming back. And this, we're preparing the way. The apostles are preparing the way. And then this actor will show up as Jesus. And then this will then just ignite a firestorm of interest around the world. Now, this may happen in other places in the world, too. It may happen in beaches in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, various places like this. The beaches provide this amphitheater, natural amphitheater. The beaches also are an inherent sensual place where people get into the body. The body beautiful, the body. It's very much designed that way. It's a very slippery slope, the beach. People tend to undress there. And they feel very sensual at the beach. So there'll be this underlying sensuality of the whole thing, which is what the reptilians want. That's what they want. Because they want this world to be this sensual, body-based, self-defining as body-based world. They want to eradicate the self-body-denying religions. And so by having Jesus return with this undercurrent of sensuality to it, this is exactly what they want. And the world is all set up for that. The world is primed for that. We're just obsessed with this underlying sensuality right now in the world. It's everywhere. In every commercial, every film, every television, it's super saturated our psyche to the point where we feel this is just natural. This is a death blow to the genuine religious aspiration in the world. It really is. This has all been planned out ahead of time. And the Bible warns us about this. It's a very key warning. they'll be, if the Bible says, if someone says, look, Jesus is back, he's low, look there, there's Jesus, look there, look, says, don't believe him, don't believe him. There'll be many false Jesuses arise just before the arrival of the true Jesus. The arrival meaning coming out into the open. Jesus is already back here in the world. But he will come out in the open. If he does that, I don't know exactly what he's going to do. But from my understanding, he's here to invite us to a reduced intensity zone. Okay. Because in the Bible, that's what he says. I'm going to come back and invite you to come to the dwelling place I have made for you, and I will dwell there with you. This is what he says. So this is how I see it. He's not here to start a new world religion, new world order, usher in the millennium, or anything like that. That is the false Jesus is doing that. So the draconian reptilian race, it's a very, very prevalent, powerful race in the cosmos. They're taking over this planet, and they're setting it up the way they want to. But this is all just a reflection of our own paranoia. All of this theater, it's just theater. Theater of the absurd, you might say. It really is theater of the absurd. It's theater of the absurd. All of it. It's theater of the absurd. It's theater in the purpose of protecting absurdity, defending absurdity. So I was, the Holy Spirit has protected me from this, waking me up to this. And the great Tibetan masters are playing a role in helping out, no question about it. They certainly know what it's all about. I can tell you that from really taking a very close look at it. They absolutely know what it's all about. Jamyangyensi Choki Lodro, said all this coming and going, bodies being born, bodies dying, all of this coming and going is just mental delusion, just a projection by the mind. It's all mental delusion. That's all it is. That's true. It's all theater of the absurd is all that it is in terms of its purpose. Now, all of this is already inherently abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness. There's only intrinsic spaciousness, actually. That's all there is. This is a good way of looking at it. I mean, we have Keith Dauman's translation of Spaciousness, the Radical Doctrine of the Vajra Heart, by, from Longchenpa. And, he does a great job at it. But also, he's very transparent in saying, I chose these words, I'm trying to translate it, so I said, let me use this word. There's other ways you can say it, which is true. Plus, he says the Dharma Dhatu can't be explained, or none of it is true. Whatever said about it's not true. It's not really the Dharma Dhatu. Is not really the Dharma Dhatu. Whatever. he points that out too, and so you can. I'm able to read this, and I'm able to see more. There's other terms you could use, other flavors, other you can get from it actually, and you could say all is just intrinsic spaciousness. There's nothing other than that actually. And the true liberated ones are just abiding as that intrinsic spacious. There's nothing else to abide as, actually. And that's genuine liberation from the notion that liberation could ever possibly be necessary, actually. So they have been very helpful. I'm profoundly pleased and grateful for the help that they have given. The ecumenical help that they're giving here, because a lot of Christianity is still worshiping Jehovah, which is an imaginary, is the god of absurdity. Actually, it's worshiping absurdity, because absurdity seems to protect us. It advises us how to protect us from non-definition, meaning from inherent abidance in inherent spaciousness. Absurdity protects us from that. It defends us from that. So we think that this is, the great protector. So we think this is God, must be God. God is giving this great advice of how to protect us from this. And so this play of false Jesus, we think, oh, that's the grace of God. God's helping us defend against the abyss of non-body identification. This is what's going on. So it's difficult to get this from a Christian perspective. It's difficult. We're sort of, Christians are sort of in this transitional thing of trying to get to the real God, and yet they're not, you know, we're not quite there. They're still hanging on. It's like sitting on the fence, so to speak. So Christians need to get off the fence. Everybody needs to get off the fence and start getting real about this whole situation. Because Jesus' testimony was a New Testament. He said, God is a God of love, and that's all God is, absolute pure love. And Jesus has given some additional testimony in A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words and the Other Voice, where he makes it crystal clear what his teaching is truly about, and re-emphasizes it in the right way. And saying, hey, you know, it's impossible for you to sin against God. It's absolutely impossible. It's impossible for there to be an angry God. God is a God of all inclusivity, all perfect love. And, you know, this is what you need to commit to. And it makes it very clear that what we are is pure freedom. That's what God is. And pure freedom obviously cannot be defined in any way. Otherwise, it wouldn't be pure freedom. Because we're always free to be whatever we want to experience. To be that experiencing. To be that experiencing. But we're never bound to, moment by moment, we're never bound. We're never, there's not any instant where we're ever bound to what we're experiencing. We're not bound by it. We're free to experience something else, always, in any direction whatsoever. All potentiality is all inherently available to us, instantly. You call this the vast spontaneity. Dahlman talks about the spontaneity of the now. It's this pure potentiality, always available, inherently, instantly, always availableness of all this potentiality. So everything is this spontaneous arising of this pure potentiality, whatever arises. There's nothing that gets in the way first. There's no boundness that needs to be, we need to extricate. Nothing needs to happen first for something other experiencing to arise, whatever we want to arise. We don't have to change our experiencing. We also can stay with whatever we have. We're free to do that as well. So you cannot define what our experiencing is and say, this is what we are, because our being is just this being. Experiencing is what our being, we're being that, but we're never just that. We're always everything and nothing. In other words, we can experience everything, but nothing in particular do we have to experience. So we need to get familiar with this. But I would, you know, many will be misled by this, what's coming up, this conspiracy, this grand conspiracy. There's no question about it. But we don't have to be misled by it. We don't have to be misled by it. We have to be aware how frightened we are of no non-definition, as if it's an abyss. But it's not an abyss, it's just, it's everything and nothing, meaning we can define ourselves any way we want to at any given instant. But it's not a definitive definition, it's an experiencing. There is no definitive definition of God. It's just this freedom. Is we're free to experience whatever we want to experience, our mind, whatever we desire to experience. So how can we have a definitive definition of our experiencing? We cannot. That would fixate us. And this is not the will of God at all. And yet, we, in trying to change God, we've tried to fixate God and say God is just an experiencing that we have, that we've fixated. We've been able to fixate. Of course, if we change God, we have to change what God is, which is freedom. So we'd have to claim that there is a definitive fixation of what God is. Therefore, there's a definitive fixation of what we are too. And then this ends up ultimately being these thingness and perception and bodies and worlds, thinking this is what we are, that we're defined. There's a definite fixation of our experiencing, which is why we have what's called nature that seems to be fixated experiencing. But it's not at all actually fixated. None of it is. This is what the real Jesus tells us. And it's interesting that Christians are being told to watch He Is Risen, where you have an actor playing Jesus who seems to be so realistic. And people are saying, my gosh, this is just like Jesus. And it's getting him ready for that, getting him ready for an actor. There may be many actors being trained for this right now. This actor said that was his goal in life, to play Jesus, and that, you know, this is it. So there may be many right at this minute, you know, are training for this role. It's just amazing what's going on. But we have to realize, look at history. There's a theater of the absurd. Look at everything that's happened. I'm going back and looking at the 60s and the 70s, I said, did that really happen? Are you kidding me? It did. It did happen. It's all theater. People playing roles, it's theater. Now, they also, people will think this will bring peace on the earth. What they really mean is this is accomplishing the reptilians' objectives for them, so that they will not have to be so heavy-handed. And that if we don't submit to them, then they'll become very heavy-handed. And so we think wrongly, oh, well, this is ushering in peace. This is helping peace, the world become peaceful. Well, it means we're being enslaved, willingly enslaved. We're enslaving ourselves instead of, battling against the enslavement, actually. Now, many Christians may not accept this. Just like many atheists, many secular humanists are accepting the Pope now as a genuine world leader and thinking he's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Whereas many Catholics and Christians are saying, oh, whoa, wait a minute. This guy looks like an Illuminati operative here, right? So many people in the world will accept this fake Jesus as the real Jesus, and they'll convert to Jesus, but they'll be really converting to the New World religion, New World Order religion, false religion that the yoga girls will be teaching, being supposedly blessed by this false Jesus. And the world's been set up to follow these yoga girls and do what they tell them to do. This is how everything's, the feminism has set this whole thing up. So it's really, really this massive theater of the absurd that has been, people have been getting their roles ready, the staging's been getting ready, the scenery, everything's, the audience, everything's being, going to this culmination of the return, a false return of Jesus, fake return. That doesn't mean there isn't a real return. It just means that this one is trying to co-opt it. Beautiful day today in California. Just summer with a cool wind. I mean, it's just amazing. Yeah. Out here in short sleeves. Well, see, Santa Monica is an ideal place for it because people can come all during the summer, the spring, the summer, and the fall, even the winter. And you can stay outdoors the whole time. In the summer, it doesn't get too hot, winter not too cold. In this massive beach, the promenade, everything, the outdoor culture there, everything. And the cleverness of it is like, wow, these people working on staging, they know what they're doing. But if you really focus on that, it's just a no-brainer. You got this massive 10-mile beach, super wide, safe beach, and just the people you can pack onto that beach and onto the above on the streets and promenade along the beach is just incredible crowds. It can accommodate incredible crowds outdoors. The weather's fine, year-round type of thing. It's ideal for it. Then Jesus will just walk along the shoreline. This is the heads up sidewalk surfing that I got. Actually, it was a heads up about what's going to take place. I knew it was very significant. And the 2-2 signifying the second coming. But in the end of that video, Jan is on the beach. He's almost dead. Dean is dead and Jan's almost dead. It's like wiped out. And it's showing you, the floundering and how it's not real, it's fake. It's amazing. And the sidewalk is the sidewalk to the ocean. If the ocean was a road, what's the sidewalk? The beach. The beach is even the color of concrete, isn't it? So sidewalk surfing, go along, grab your board and go. Sidewalk surfing is to travel along this beach area. Travel along this beach area, the shoreline. Jesus will be down near the ocean, walking along the shoreline. The people will be on the beach, the sandy, more sandy, softer area of the beach, stretching all the way back up then to the boardwalk promenade along the beach, and then up in the streets, and able to see him. You know, everyone's able to see him pretty much, just, especially if you're elevated. And it's just, you know, massive throngs. And they're set up for that. The porta potties are right in the bathrooms are there. The porta potties are used to huge crowds there. So civically, they'll be able to handle that. And then Jesus will walk along and, you know, with the apostles blessing the crowds along the shoreline like that. And people will be on their knees, you know, and genuflecting. And it'll just be this huge revival, false revival, massive revival is planned in this way. And the emotionalism will just be astonishing, you know. And the apostles will just be swept up. Everybody will be swept up in this emotionalism. Fervency, massive fervency. And again, the media center of the world, they will be able to send links to every place in the world. Everyone will have live feeds of all this taking place. 24/7 live feeds. And movies churned out about it. Interviews, massive amount of interviews. It'll become the biggest media event in history, actually. And so it's very tempting to be part of that, right? You can understand how tempting it is to say, well, you know, maybe I can do a lot of good there. And maybe I can explain truth to the you know, the cameras on me. I can explain truth and get it out to people. And you think the end justifies the means. It's a very slippery slope. And some of the contingent of yoga girls, their job is to keep the apostles happy, quote unquote happy. They're whores, basically. High class whores. And the apostles might be... they might be sequestered, like at Malibu, some estates in Malibu, actually, which is very close. And they may arrive, they might take a boat from Malibu to Santa Monica, around the coastline there, and get off a boat and walk ashore in the water. You know, it's all very symbol, very, very cinematic. The whole thing is planned to be very cinematic. Films, drama and cinema and all this kind of stuff. Jesus coming in, walking, you know, through the surf. And you know, say, well, Jesus, why don't you walk on the water? He says, well, I'm not doing those kind of miracles now, you know, something like that. but, yeah. And so, you know, they'll have unlimited these yoga girls. There's some very, very, you know, dedicated prostitutes who will be designed to keep all the apostles and all the ones that are actors and, you know, staging this whole thing, keep them happy. If they start to have second thoughts, you know, these prostitutes, their job is to sex them up and get them feeling like, oh, it's all good, it's all blissful, you know. Yeah, this is how it works. This is how the reptilians work. Absolutely is. They use sex in every possible way they can. They're completely shameless about it. Absolutely shameless about it. Drugs, too. There'll be all sorts of drugs used to keep everybody in line. You know, to make sure you don't go off wander off the reservation. And maybe some apostles will commit suicide or something, and then they'll have to replace them to say, ah, you know, they were overwhelmed, or they tried to betray Jesus, and this is their just desserts, their karma. People say, oh yeah, okay. And then a new apostle will show up, you know, to, like, you know, take the place of like Judas Iscariot. And yeah, I'm just like, wow, all this theater is being revealed to me. I'm seeing this setup of intention. The intention is to put on this theater. And if you look at it, you say, oh, sure, they could do it. Piece of cake, actually. You get people are willing to do it, and they are. There's nothing stopping them. What's stopping them from doing it? Nothing. Because the people will fall for it. And how can they not? There's the people are so immersed in this paranoia, really, they have not worked through it. So they're just like sitting ducks for this, sitting ducks for it. And the Christians might fight against it, but the world will say, no, you're wrong, and become very hostile towards them. of course, Christians believing in Jehovah, they're control freaks too, and they just want to control everything their way, actually. So they don't know the real God at all. A lot of them don't know the real God. Which is why they're so close-minded to genuine teachings. They're able to twist teachings of Christianity into a dualistic teaching and worship an absurdist God. And then when the real teachings come in to fix that, they say, oh, you know, that's, you can't go outside of this narrow box that we're in. It's paranoia. Some of these Tibetans, really, they really know the truth. They really do. Some of them, I can't vouch for the whole thing at all. I mean, it's you know, there's different differences, but definitely there is a genuine transmission, a genuine awareness there coming from Buddha and those who Buddha has raised up, you know, to enlightenment. That whole transmission of Buddha, absolutely, there are those who know the true God. And really, from their own words, it's a trinity. It's an absolute trinity. Exactly the same as Christianity, really. Same sort of trinity thing. And these three quote-unquote bodies are attributes of the one inseparable Godhead. These three attributes, they call them bodies. Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, Nirmanakaya. They're all one. They're all one. Exactly the same as the Trinity. It's the same explanation, actually. So they certainly know the true God. And very, very, you know, have worked it through to an extraordinary extent. All the different delusive states of mind, how to shift out of those, how to work with it, how to get ultimately liberated. It is amazing the amount of effort they've put into it. And Christians tend to misrepresent the Trinity, the Buddhist Trinity, Trikaya, three body. But in looking at it really objectively, just objectively, it's the same. You can see it's just really exactly the same. The Nirmanakaya is appearance here in this world of the divine, which Jesus was. He was a Nirmanakaya appearance here, absolutely. This is an attribute of the divine that it's actually able to appear, the appearance body here. The action body, appearance body, can appear here, like Buddha appearing here, like Jesus appearing here. Yes, that's and then Sambhogakaya is more what we would call the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and the Dharmakaya is God, the Prime Creator. We would call it God, the Prime Creator. These are three aspects of one Godhood. Three aspects. But they're all inseparably one. They're not separate. They're all simply one. But with these there's these expressions pragmatically, it seems as though there's these attributes at play, okay? So they've had the same struggle with this Trinity as Christianity's had the struggle with their Trinity. But the Nirmanakaya, the appearance of the divine, they recognize it's mere appearance. It's mere appearance, actually. Which Jesus was, it was mere appearance. Mere appearance. And unfortunately, the Council of Chalcedonian Creed was a political compromise to get Roman authorities off the back of Christians. Rome was going to crack down on Christianity. They'd already cracked down on it a number of times severely, and they were ready to crack down on it again because they couldn't agree. There are too many squabbles. And so the emperor insisted that they get together and hammer out their differences and come up with a creed. It was a demand from the Roman emperor. Okay, it's very important to know this. So, you know, Christians don't get a complex. They have a complex of we're the only ones that know truth, and this leaves them vulnerable. Vulnerable to errors, you know, to correcting their errors. Is this agreement that the Chalcedonian Creed, what was a compromise by those who said, we got to get the Romans off, the authorities off our backs at all costs, or else they're going to eradicate us, the way they eradicated the Jews. And Jerusalem, you know, actually desolating it. You know, of course, many Christians were Jews, and they tended to be argumentative and get into disputes about the Trinity and who Jesus really was and all this stuff, you know. And so there were riots in cities and civil discord and all this conflict among early Christians because they're trying to, you know, come to grips with what the truth. They're making a great effort. So what happened was, as often does, the Roman authorities came to the church doctors, the ones in authority in the churches, the bishops, and told them, you have to come up with a unified creed, and you have to do it now. Otherwise, we're going to take action against you. And of course, the wives of these powerful politicians certainly wanted that too, because this was threatening their ISIS cult, which is Egyptian religion. They're very, very into that, worshiping ISIS, the women of Rome, the aristocratic women. So the emperor said, look, suppressing it all was going to be a problem, but they're willing to do that. But they said, look, work with us on this. Give us a unified creed. And so what happened was, they forged a compromise, because there were ones who said that Jesus was fully human, others say he was fully divine, and they said, okay, look, we'll just make it both fully human and fully divine. And then how to reconcile it? You know, it's an absurdity, but how do you reconcile it? Mystery, faith, hypostatic union, there's this mysterious mystery that, well, which is what? Absurdity. So at that point, they really put the religion on an absurdist foundation. And then the Roman Empire says, great, okay. So we can keep the ISIS cult, we'll just shoehorn it into Christianity, our wives will be happy, and we'll make this the official religion of the Roman Empire, Decree of Constantine, and from then on everything is great. And we'll now conquer under this banner, and we're unified, and this is what happened. And then the ones who didn't go along with that were excommunicated, like, you know, Nestorianism. Those who said it is a single, it's not dualistic. Jesus is just a single nature, divine nature. Monophysicists, or maybe you call them, they were banned from the church, excommunicated, exiled. They just got rid of them all, you know, into the boondocks. You're out of here. And so from this time on, you had this official Christianity, but you also had the spirit of Jesus and the apostles still was moving. The momentum, the Holy Spirit was still moving. So you had all these schisms that kept happening because people said, wait a minute, you know, I don't think this is right. And so the authorities had to keep oppressing, trying to keep this single, you know, empire religion of the empire. You couldn't conquer cities. I mean, Rome is a conquering empire. You can't go into some city without a religion to give the people that you conquer, because they have their strong pagan, you know, religions there. Come on. So you can't leave them with no religion, and you can't have them practicing the old religion, because that's a rallying point of cohesiveness to resist Rome. So what Romans had to do is that when we conquer, we have to say, this is our religion, and you can't have the legions arguing with one another over whether Jesus was human or divine or whatever, both. So they said, look, this is the creed that we're conquering under, and this is what the legions must believe. This is our official religion, and this is the religion that we're going to give you, people that we conquer, and so that we can all rebuild the city, get commerce, bring prosperity back, and we'll all be happy. There's no divisions within this than the cities they conquer, because they can't have valuable manpower policing cities that are in riot. You know, they can't have cities rioting. You can't have an empire with all your cities are rioting. So you got to understand this is just a very pragmatic, you know, empire perspective that they had. So they said, this is Christianity. This is what you have to believe. Here are your priests, here are your bishops, here are your churches, and you're going to go to church, and this is, you know, you're converted officially. And it's very important to have the mother worship in there, the mother Virgin Mary worship in there, because most of these, a lot of the people they conquered were goddess worshippers, pagan goddess worshippers. So it's a pragmatic thing. It's a pragmatic thing they did. Didn't have anything to do with, much to do with Jesus at all, actually. Because there's only divinity. That's all there is. This is the real truth. There's no such thing as humanity. There never has been. There's only inherent abidance, inherent spaciousness of all. That's all there is. Everything is inherently divine. So, but this is something that people have difficulty with, so the people were not able to really grasp this. So they're arguing, you know, they're projecting their paranoia. Everybody's paranoid. So they're trying to get one creed. This is it. We'll knock, bust your head if you don't believe it. And so they shoehorned as many into that as possible and conquered under that banner. Absolutely conquered under that banner. You know, conquerors are very pragmatic in terms of, you know, what do we do once we conquer this city? Obviously, right? Isn't that foremost on their mind ahead of time? They can't afford the city to be chaos. They've got to organize it quickly. Look at Alexander the Great, you know, how he's able to organize all the cities he conquers. Amazing. Hellenized it. Here's the culture, basically. Here's the culture that you're going to now, you know, be like. And so these very warlike pagan tribes in Europe and the Roman Empire, where they were conquered, they're very warlike. And when you conquer them, you've got to give them you can't have them become fractious. You cannot. And so the idea of this crucified Savior, that look what we did to our Savior, we absolutely crucified the heck out of him. And that's okay. You know, somehow it appealed to these pagan mindset. And they're able to pacify the countryside. You know, you have to pacify when you conquer. You got to pacify the countryside. You need these churches everywhere. This is just real history here. The fact, numbers don't mean truth, okay? So the Roman Empire conquered a lot of people, numbers. That doesn't mean that they were bringing a true religion to all these people. It means they were bringing a pragmatically effective religion to pacify them as much as possible. But the real teachings of Jesus are not exactly the same as what you're getting in the religion of Christianity, really. Some of it's there. You have to look carefully, but you have to be really discerning, and you need the Holy Spirit's discernment to see it, actually. They call it the Holy Roman Empire. Holy Roman Empire. And we're still, that's still going, actually. It's still going. And this new world order is just the next incarnation of the Holy Roman Empire. You might say the Catholic Church is an extension of the Holy Roman Empire. They have about 1.2 billion Catholics around the world. It's totally worldwide. So the Pope of the Vatican has enormous power. And it's so institutionalized that their goal is to keep the institution going. So, and therefore they have to keep pacifying, you know, the people that they're under their shepherding. They have to keep them pacified. And there's something about, you know, the absurdist religion. It's really absurdist religion they're teaching. And this crucified Jesus is very important to them, and someone paid the price for our sins. See, because absurdity, it feels very threatened by us, because we're the ones who are actually projecting absurdity. And so absurdity is just a mental projection, and it wants to destroy us, because it knows that we can take away absurdity. Absurdity feels that's going to be plunged into annihilation or something, even though it's just pretension. And of course, what can happen to pretension? Nothing. Nothing. I mean, the rope is just pretending to be a snake. What happens? It stops pretending. What happened to the snake? Nothing. It was never there. It was just a pretense. But as long as we have this fear, we keep thinking that it's you know, something can happen, absurdity, some separate entity. It's not our own pretense. So the absurdity is totally paranoid and wants to destroy us, you know, but it's afraid to destroy us because it thinks maybe that will destroy me too. So it needs a scapegoat to put all our sins upon it. It absurdity thinks we're so sinful because we keep wanting to drop definition of what we are, which absurdity claims is trying to destroy God, you know. So we have to pay the price for this terrible sin, and so all the sins are put on Jesus, and Jesus was terribly tortured, and he was tortured and crucified, you know, according to this, the Bible, tortured, severely tortured and crucified in a terrible way, and that's supposed to pay the price. So now that reconciles us with this absurdist God, you know. This is what the religion is based on, really, to the way that the Holy Roman Empire has exported it. It's not what Jesus taught, actually. It's not. And Jesus makes that very clear in A Course in Miracles. Is what I taught has been greatly distorted and twisted into idolatry of a cruel, insane, idol God. And absurdity, really. We're just worshiping absurdity in death. That is not to say that the Bible isn't accurate in terms of what happened. Maybe it's quite accurate in terms of the crucifixion of Jesus. Maybe it did take place. The resurrection, you know, likely took place. All that. It's just that it was misinterpreted, and especially the Chalcedonian Creed, what was a political document, not a real genuine religious document. Actually, it was a political expedient to say, look, if we don't do this, we won't have any Christianity at all. We're going to be wiped out. So they appeased and forged this compromise. And to this day, you know, we're still uneasy about it, right? There's this feeling like, it's not quite right. And there's something that isn't quite right. And then those who are worshiping the absurdist God say, no, we got it just right. This is how absurdity wants it. And you can see when you finally start cutting through this knot of absurdity, then you can see it all, and you just say, wow, this is really, that's how it is. Yeah, we have been worshiping absurdity to protect us from what absurdity claims is to be our own annihilation. Because we think absurdity is God, and then to drop definition, all absurdity will disappear. And then we think, oh, God has disappeared. And we don't quite see that when we drop absurdity, God doesn't disappear, God appears. As inherent spaciousness of everything, all is just inherent spaciousness and perfect freedom. That's when we wake up from this terrible dream of absurdity and say, oh, it was always just dreaming. So this is all very intense. I'm having, you know, it's just so much strain on me right now. Wow, it's horrible. But, you know, I'm getting through it, just working through it here. The problem is paranoia drives everybody here. It really does. And you need to see it. You need to see what the root of that is. Wow. It's the fear that if I don't define myself, I won't have a self. Well, we don't have a specific self in that way. We have just the moment-by-moment flow of experiencing. But you can't define ourself. So when someone asks, what are you? I say, I don't know. But I say that is it the answer? Not as like I'm stupid. But no, I know what I am. And what I am is I don't know what I am. Meaning I cannot be definitively defined at all. So we're afraid of that. Well, that means I don't have a self. No, we absolutely have a conscious, aware self that is experiencing. But we are the experiencing. We are that. Without being diminished or changed, our freedom is not changed by our experiencing. God being God, in other words. However we want to have our experiencing being, that doesn't change our freedom and our beingness. So you might say we're just pure being. But you cannot specifically say being as what? See, there's no definition as what. I'm everything and nothing. So I don't know what I am. What are you? I don't know. I don't know what I am. I don't know. And Jesus said, when you could say, I don't know, he said this in Journey Beyond Words, if you could say, I don't know, and probably in A Course in Miracles too, he said this, if you could say, I don't know, and accept that as your definition of what you are, accept that this is what you really are, I don't know, and say it positively, he says, this means you are truly, you truly get it, you truly get it, and you are right there. As far as liberation goes, you're truly on the doorstep of liberation, and you've opened the door to truth. You've opened the door, actually. You can say, I don't know is what I am. I don't know. I don't know. I said that yesterday. I was just thinking, like, I'm obituary, and people say, well, how do you define yourself? What was your life? And I said, well, first I said, well, my obituary will say I was resurrected from the dead. And then it will say, I'm going to say, who am I? What was I? I don't know. I don't know. But I said it in a positive way. It reverberated through me like, wow, this is true. Truly, I don't know what I am. I do not know. And this is an accurate assessment of what we are. And it's like, wow. So all this stuff is coming up right now. It's just a massive amount of stuff coming up. Along with this cosmic conspiracy, this attempted great deception by reptilians. They're known for this. Okay, so we should not be surprised about this at all. It's just business as usual from their standpoint is all it is. This is just their thing. This is how they move. This is what they do. This is their business. They know their business. You just realize that. They know their business. This is what they do. So they're used to putting on the grand deception. They're used to it. And so we should just say, okay, you know, just another stupid movie they're producing, right? But people say, well, that's blasphemy. No, this is about the return of Jesus. You can't say that. You know, well, yes, we can say that. Truth is true, no matter who says it. You know, it doesn't matter who says the truth, what the labels you want to label them as. Truth is still exactly true. There's this inherent spaciousness of all there is, and there's this the abidance as that, and we are in perfect freedom. This is something we will become aware of at some point, but this inherent abidance, just there is already, that's all there is in terms of thingness. It's just everything is in this inherent spaciousness. Its own inherent spaciousness, and everything is in its own inherent spaciousness. You can say there's only this abidance in inherent spaciousness, which is true. So one of the ways we're being helped here to not fall for this false return of Jesus, the false second coming that's being staged, theatrically staged, faked, is that we're aware of truth from different angles. And so if we're not afraid, you know, if we say, no, this isn't true, and we think, oh, I'm going to lose faith in Jesus, and Jesus will say he doesn't know me and withdraw the teachings from me and stuff, because we're afraid this is what will happen. And that's, if we don't go along with the crowd in this, we think maybe I'm going to be cut off from Jesus, which is not true at all. It's a fake Jesus here we're talking about. Well, we can just say, well, that doesn't really matter, because I have teachers from other angles too. They're not cutting me off. The truth is true. Doesn't matter who's speaking it. There's no monopoly on truth at all. How could there be a monopoly on inherent abidance of everything? What could have that monopoly? What could be cast out of inherent abidance? Nothing can. Nothing can be cast out. There's no casting outness at all. Absurdity claims there is, because absurdity thinks it has been cast out, and so it's creating this separate kingdom. Absurdity is completely confused. It's just absurd, actually. There's nothing it can understand. But nothing can be cast out. There's no casting outness at all. How can anything be cast out from its own inherent spaciousness? Just consider that question. And that's all you really need to consider. You just look at that. I mean, this bottle, how could it be cast out from its own inherent spaciousness? Is it not abiding in spaciousness? And can't you not say it has, you know, it's abiding in its own inherent spaciousness? It cannot remove itself from that in any way. If you move it, how is it moving out of its own inherent spaciousness? How could you cast it out? You know, I'm throwing this. How does throwing it remove it from its own inherent spaciousness? There's no separation from God. There's no casting outness from God at all. None whatsoever is impossible. Those who seem to be cast out are just in an absurdist mindset, absurdist belief system, which requires identifying with the body to an extreme extent and overlooking the inherent abidance and pure spaciousness, inherent spaciousness of it all. That it's special. It has to do with specialness of bodies. And special relationships. It focuses on romantic love, sensual love, special relationships, physicality, all this stuff. This is necessary to remain insane, really. And to refuse to recognize the abidance of all in its own inherent spaciousness. Everything is already in its own inherent spaciousness. There's no path to this at all, is there? How could there be a path? In order to be a path, we say this needs to get back to its inherent spaciousness. Well, it would have to be out of its inherent spaciousness to get back to it, wouldn't it? Where can this be where it's out of its own inherent spaciousness? It's ridiculous. It's absurd. Completely absurd. So there's no path back to inherent spaciousness. There's no attainment of it. How can it attain? Well, it's already there. There's zero attainment involved. There's zero attainment involved. Zero attainment involved. No path, no attainment. No realization as an attainment. There's a realization of this. Dawn spots. Oh, wow. I don't need any attainment. So the realization of truth is not some agency of truth. You know, it didn't bring it about at all. It's, you can say it's non-causative. Didn't cause anything to happen. So nothing needs to be caused to happen at all for truth to be recognized. Nothing at all. Nothing ever has to happen at all. This is true right now. This instant will always be true. Because everything is already inherently abiding in its in inherent spaciousness. It's already the case. There's nothing that needs to happen. Nothing needs to be done whatsoever. There's a lot of movement going on here, so I'm just like, what's that? What's that? People moving around. Now, you cannot just go to homeless people and just teach them this. Oh, yeah, I get it. You know, it's not like that. It requires enormous dedication and love of truth and thinning out the continuity fear and thinning out the paranoia. You cannot just take someone who's rabidly paranoid with all the defenses of paranoia and just have this dawn upon them and they just abide in it. You know, this is pragmatically an absurdity to expect that. what could happen is you can have someone like teaching this, going among homeless people, and then going to the authorities and say, look, I can help these homeless people and teach them the truth, and can you help them out and give them more food and some help, and then the homeless get help from the authorities, and then they can start claiming that they're getting, oh yes, I've had a great realization, I've been really blessed or something. But what they really mean is they're getting food. And so you can create a false movement among the homeless people like that, a populist movement. You really can. But they can claim, I mean, they're good. I mean, you know, I'll tell you what. You get someone who's desperate and starving and homeless, they'll say anything to get some shelter, get some food, get some medical care. They'll say anything. I've come across this. What do you want me to say? You want me to say, I've had a miracle, I saw the light, and now I understand the truth, it's miraculous. Give me the food. Like a drug addict. Drug addict will say or do anything to get their drugs. You cannot rely as that reliable witnesses like that. You cannot at all. So it's easy to spread a populist revival among the downtrodden and homeless. Easy. It's not legitimate. It's not legitimate. This type of realizing truth is something that requires great clarity and commitment and love of truth and tremendous effort to thin out the continuity fear and the paranoia and to see it. It's a great undertaking, actually. Now, people can get a glimpse of it, but then the paranoia comes roaring back in because it threatens absurdity. They say, oh my gosh, that's threatening my God. What do I do? My God feels angry at me. I need a sacrifice. God's very angry at me. I mean, the God of paranoia was furious with Jesus. So they said, what do we do? And then God of paranoia says, crucify him. I'll accept the crucifixion of him. And then I won't be so angry at you. My paranoia will be reduced. You know, so like, in other words, give him such a hideous death that it'll never happen again. Nobody will ever want to come here again and threaten me this way. And the people said, oh, great. Okay, God, we'll do that. So a populist revival is very possible to fake all of that. Fake it all. Absolutely it is. You just have to have some messianic figures involved. Is all that's required, actually. And the rabble, the people will go along with that if they're getting fed and bred, you know, bred in circuses, etc. And they think they're being important. If you shine a light of media on them, I mean, oh my gosh, shoot into aggrandizement, and they think that I'm suddenly somebody, I'm important now. They just need these center seeds of messianic-like figures to seed the populist revival, actually, and then film it all, etc. Create a worldwide populist movement. It's very easy. Actually, to do. So the apostles will be these messianic-like figures, and Jesus will then be the actor. Jesus will be the center of this, and it can spread out like a grassroots wildfire around the world. Because so many people will be downtrodden coming up with economic problems that have come. People will be desperate for messianic revival. Of something to believe in that doesn't trigger paranoia, right? So when you're under severe stress and hardships, it's difficult to have this calm, clear meditation, full stop in the wild meditation. You need to have a peaceful, settled surroundings. It's very helpful that you not be under duress, survival duress, which is why these reduced intensity zones are so helpful for this. This world is a difficult place for it. Longchenpa advised living your life in a cave, essentially, making sure you have the simple food, rice, eat a very simple diet, you know, the necessities, but keep it very simple and quiet and calm and peaceful, and so you can really look at the mind, look within. You have to look within with great courage, because the paranoia jumps up and bites you, it's barking at you. You got all these dogs of paranoia barking at you. Oh, and speaking of dogs, there will be a massive amount of dogs there. There's huge amount of dogs in that area. People will bring their dogs with them, and that helps them excessive animal devotion helps them identify with the belief they're animals and therefore incapable of dropping definition. It's a way to strengthen their definition of what they are rather than realize they have no definition. Now, I like animals, absolutely. Who doesn't like it? A lot of, you know, they're wonderful, right? But it's just, it can be taken to an excessive fanatical extent. This excessive animal devotion and worship is a very, very bad sign. It means that people are frantic to keep defining themselves and being ruled by their paranoia. See, like right now, I just pretty much ignore dogs. If a dog runs up to me or something, you know, I say, hello, you know. A dog was straying recently. I called it back home, patted on the head, good dog, you know, came home. You know, animals can be helpful for our stress, etc. But it's way, way, way overboard right now in the world. It's become a mania, actually, because it's how people are trying to ground themselves in definition. They're afraid of the real return of Jesus. And they're trying to ground themselves in a physical definition of what they are. This is why they're so obsessed with animals right now. Very obsessed. Yoga girls are extraordinarily obsessed with animals. They're trying frantically to define themselves as physically, to make their physical appearance as attractive as possible, and as strong and as possible, and, you know, just really concrete as possible. And to fashion themselves, you know, the style and fashion, and they have their dogs, and they're just so into physical culture, so into it. And of course, coating it with a spiritual style. Sugarcoating it, right? To make it seem like a religion so they can spread this populism, this populistic revival. Remember, ultimately, who did the rabble choose? Barabbas. He was a messianic figure, wasn't he? Promised them food, more money. They said, crucify Jesus, crucify him. So once you become a messianic figure to the rabble, you better keep on delivering the goods for them. You better, if you start trying to teach real truth, etc., they'll turn on you. They'll crucify you. They'll turn on you and crucify you. So Jesus always delivered the truth. People are always trying to crucify him. And he kept slipping through their grasp. They couldn't find him. Couldn't find him. So Jesus was not really a populist. Was not. He actually appealed to those who had the greatest depth of clarity. Most people didn't know he was. I don't understand what you're saying. He says, well, you will. So it was a lot of the brilliant Jews and Greeks, Greco-Roman Empire, a lot of them were converted because, they may have been Platonists, Platonius, or whatever you call it, following Plato, who was a brilliant philosopher. There was a heavy, heavy intelligentsia back then, and a lot of them picked up on what Jesus was saying to some extent. It wasn't the homeless rabble. No, where did people get this idea that Jesus was some populist? You know, he was humble, you know, but they turned him into a populist to spread the religion, right? To subdue the kingdom, to subdue the rabble. But most of the people were brilliant. Look at St. Paul, he was brilliant. These people were philosophers. There was an enormous amount of philosophy in the ancient world around the Greeks. The Greeks had spread this Hellenistic, you know, culture and philosophy. And the Egyptians also, a lot of brilliant philosophers from Egypt. And the Jews were brilliant. Many were brilliant as well, right? So these people were very sophisticated and cultured people, and they had the capacity to sit quietly. They had that nice homes, enough food. They could do meditation, they could do contemplation, they could do prayer, they could do study. And then some of them decide to become, you know, renunciates, desert fathers down on the Nile. So someone on the upper Nile, but I think, was it by Thebes or something? And a lot of desert fathers went there, and they became hermits and stuff. But these people were a lot of them were brilliant. Brilliant. A lot of them came from wealthy families, wealthy backgrounds. We're not talking about Jesus going to you know, he healed. He did a lot of healing among the poor people, okay? So we think he was a populist, but he was just showing that it's all pretense. But he didn't get Christianity on a rise from beggars. Come on. From homeless beggars. Where do we get this notion that it was a populist, really populist movement? This is absurd rewriting of history to say this. The church fathers, the doctors, and the bishops, these were brilliant leaders and philosophers, you know, of just the top notch, that they were able to, you know, see, okay, synthesize everything, all these ideas, and work with these ideas and see, start seeing past them, you know, and see what Jesus is really saying. You needed a tremendous intellect and clarity to do this. And like Dzogchen, radical Dzogchen, they say this is for those of tremendous capacity. Otherwise, you can't get it. You'll keep being dragged back into gradualism. You need to be very, very keen to recognize what it's pointing at. I'm not just some, you know, dumb person. I'm a genius. I was born a genius. Along with tremendous discipline and determination. So, you know, this has to be pointed out. We're not some dummies here. We're not beggars on this, you know, just say, oh, you know, Jesus, this, I understand what you're saying. You give me food, that's great. Multiply the loaves. That's not how it works. A lot of these homeless people are drug addicts. Sex addicts, drug addicts, addicts of all different types. Some of them may be brilliant. Okay, we're not saying that's not possible. It is possible, actually. So it is possible for some of them to convert. That's maybe the exception. Okay, I mean, there are people that are homeless that are geniuses too. Okay, this absolutely does happen. But it's a tough place to gain clarity from. It's a tough vantage point to gain clarity from. But that would be more the exception than the rule, sort of thing. But Hollywood loves these populist stories, doesn't it? And of course, Hollywood, what do they want? Money. It's a money machine. They have no morality in Hollywood, none whatsoever. They have no scruples, no morals, no morality whatsoever. Their god is money, plain and simple. Mammon, okay. And they want the reptilians, they want a unified global culture of this sensuality culture, body culture, so they can keep selling these films. Everybody will watch their movies. They want a world where everybody spends their free time watching movies, which is what a lot of people do now anyway. Okay? They got their dogs and they got their movies. That's it. And some drugs, sex and drugs thrown in, music thrown in there too. This is the kind of culture Hollywood wants. They want everybody to be this way. So they can just become even richer. I mean, when you worship the god of money, it's never enough because you're still completely paranoid. So it doesn't matter how much money you have, you always want more, a lot more. So Hollywood's very, very willing contributor to all this reptilian takeover of this planet. They're completely in bed with that. Because this mindset, the sensual, flesh-based mindset of body definition, they crave these films that Hollywood just cranks out. I mean, Hollywood just cranks out the same stuff, just garbage, nothing but garbage. This is all they've ever done is garbage, actually. Never made a real film at all. They can't. They're incapable. They have no awareness of truth. They're flesh-based. They're immoral. Amoral, you name it. It's just junk. What they put out is just absolute junk. It's for imbeciles, actually. So they want an imbecilic audience. And this global control system that is coming with technology designed to externally control everybody, they love it. This is what they want. Movies on demand. Everybody will be sitting there, Netflix every day, just, you know, zombies watching the movies. Cash cows. So they're all in on all of this. They're absolutely co-conspirators with all this. bummer, you know. Yeah, and I'm sorry to paint such a picture. But it's true. You know, it's true. This stuff is what's happening. But we need to look at it, laugh about it, and bring it to light, and say, oh, okay, yeah, business as usual. So what? I'm not going to lose any sleep over it. It's all pretense anyway. Everything's already abiding in pure spaciousness. Everything's there's no lack of salvation anywhere. There's not any need for salvation anywhere, actually. Everything's perfect. All is perfect, exactly as God created perfection to be. Everything's functioning perfectly, actually. So, inherent abidance and inherent spaciousness is what is already, this is already present everywhere. There's no place where it's not present. You can't go anywhere where it's not present. Does the ocean loot? Does inherent abidance disappear when the ocean turns into a wave? No, the wave is abiding in its own inherent spaciousness, as is the breaking wave, as is the foam, as the white water. There's no loss of inherent spaciousness anywhere. Nothing abandons itself. We can't abandon ourselves. Nothing abandons experiencing. It's impossible. So just simple recognition of this fact is all that's required. I saw that November 2nd, 2013. I was in the shower and I just sort of suddenly just dawned upon me, oh, now I get what it is. I just recognize, oh, it's inherent spaciousness. It doesn't matter, the bird flying through the air is not moving at all away from its inherent spaciousness. It's not moving one iota away from its inherent spaciousness, is it? Its inherent abidance in spaciousness. No movement is moving out of its inherent spaciousness. So from the standpoint of inherent spaciousness, there's no movement towards or away from it at all taking place. There's just perfect abidance taking. That's all there is. It's completely still in that way. There's no action. There's no change taking place in it, and no change at all. And so I just was aware of that, became aware of that after the dream of meeting Longchenpa. I became aware of it. And I just said, oh, so that's it. That's all I said. Oh, so that's it. Well, that's simple. I mean, oh, so easy. Nothing has to be done. We don't have to stuff anything back into its abidance, do we? Nothing has to be fixed in that regard, okay? Now, the fact, you know, well, I know I keep going on and I can go on forever, can I? It's just a simple recognition. Oh, so that's it. So there's this enormous pressure in the world for messianic figures, but for these messianic figures to get into this script. The yoga girls are trying to get them into this script. That's what, there's a contingent. The yoga girls is this massive body of actresses, and there's many different subspecialties and contingents, like divisions in an army, so to speak, and different contingents of yoga girls have different roles to play, and one of them is to locate these messianic figures and get them into the script, this fake Return of Jesus script, to be these populist figures, you know, to and galvanize this populist New World Order religion. So I'm definitely in the crosshairs, you know, of the yoga girls in this regard. So I'm keeping a low profile. I could easily, you know, do that. Because in some regards, I am a messianic figure. That's not a bad term. It's how you use it. I mean, if you're aligned with truth, this is your very messianic figure. If you're eloquent about it, etc., have the charisma. You can really, the charisma can be, you know, really poured out. Absolutely, but it's how you use it, and you cannot allow this to be blackmailed or steered by the yoga girls into this populist figure, highlighting a fake return of Jesus and a fake religion. So I have to be aware of that. It's not like I, you know, it's a tricky thing. You want to help out, and you want to have the spiritual charisma, but again, there's this insane pressure to be seduced into this false script. Very bad pressure. It may be so bad it's best to leave this world, go to a different reduced intensity zone. This is what I think may happen. I don't know. It may happen because I can feel the pressure on me. It's just terrible. Because this will seem, this is where it's at. We're establishing a new world order, new culture, new religion. And this is where everybody's going to do, go for it. And you're going to be some very important foundation stone of this new religion, you know. And it's just the inducements are just like insane. And insane inducements from every angle, actually. So I can dress the part, I can look the part, and I can look at myself and say, ah, okay, you know. It's no big deal. What's the big deal about it? You don't want to be, you know, suddenly caught up in this, oh yeah, you know, caught by this inducement, swept away by it, and then get into all this messianic appearancing and talk, etc. You want to already be comfortable with that and say, ah, you know, it's no big deal. It's you know, the thrill, there's sort of an adrenaline thrill about it initially. So you should already be in good shape and already be able to look the part, etc. Just so you could see, feel like, ah, you know, I can take it or leave it. It's no big deal. It's no big adrenaline rush for me at all. That enables you to keep thinking clearly about the situation. Whereas if you're out of shape, the yoga girls and the yoga girls say, look, we'll give you this fabulous makeover. You're going to become this fabulous messianic figure. You're so wonderful. You can speak this, but you just don't quite look the part yet. So we can help you with that. Then you get into their clutches. Then you get into their clutches. And when you get in their clutches, that is bad news indeed. So I could put on the Ritz, you know, as good as anybody. No problem. Even have the surfer look, the SoCal look here, everything. But for, you know, but for me, it's okay. I could do it without the help of the yoga girls. I could either do it or not do it. Doesn't matter. See, this is the advantage, leverage I have at this point. I'm already that. I can use it any way I want to. I'm not going to be blackmailed, you know, and get in their clutches. Because then you really are in trouble. Because they'll destroy your reputation if you don't do what they say. You'll be, you know, like, they feel like you're nothing. Nothing. They'll invent whatever lies they need to invent. And they'll back each other up, and you got no ground to stand on at all. And if you want to be the messianic figure, losing your reputation entirely, it feels suicidal, you know? But you have to be grounded in truth and know whether anyone listens to you or not that you're legitimate anyway. So it doesn't matter. The numbers don't matter at all, actually. And it's not a populist thing. So you may not play a big role. You're not going to play any role at all in the New World religion, actually. You won't play any role at all. But you have to see a bigger picture that when buyer's regret sets in, you'll be available to help out. So I don't know who could be helped right now at this time. The pressure on the world is so strong that people, I think, are just like, they don't know what to think, actually. It's a dangerous thing to get a populist following right now, actually. Very dangerous thing. And these yoga girls are very skillful of promoting you, filming you, videotaping, social, making you popular on social media, all this stuff. They've trained in all of that. So if you do what they say, they can make you very famous and popular. If you don't do what they say, nobody will pay attention to you. You know, they're able to just squash it. This is all what's happening right now. So if you don't sell out, you know, it may be difficult to get any message out at all here. And then the temptation, the frustration builds, and then you get easy to get tricked, you know, into the clutches of the yoga girls and their blackmailing and seduction and all of that. I mean, gorgeous house in Malibu, you know, all this money, meeting all these celebrities, being filmed around the world. The inducements will go on and on and on and on. Whatever you want, You know, everyone in the world is going to know your name and know who you are, and think you're saving them, and you know you're part of this great salvational thing, and you get statues and monuments will be made to you. You'll be in the temples and everything, you know, just all this stuff, and you'll be worshipped from now till forever, and blah 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 blah, and like, you know, that stuff starts spinning your head along with the physicality of the yoga girls, the all the sexual seduction and all that they bring into it, and the drugs and the music and the notoriety, just a whole massive complex of all this stuff, plus a desire to help the poor people, you know, help the pop, get people into accepting Jesus and everything. It's all right there on a platter in front of you if you just sell out. So there may be some way to, you know, head off this temptation. There needs to be some way. You have to be aware of the temptation. Like in the Bible, again, they said the temptation will be so severe it is capable of deceiving the elect of God. That's how severe the temptation will be. And it's already here. It's going to become this going to become this strong coming up soon. And so those who are genuine really need to take precautions not to be hooked into this, really. This is how I feel. You need to sidestep it. Sidestep all of this stuff. Sidestep the temptation, enormous temptation. Well, This man gave me a heads up today. It was amazing. I was asking for help from God. I asked him a question. I said, he was in the service. I said, oh, how come you didn't stay in the service? You know, he said, well, I wanted to. But I wanted to do this particular job. This is what I'm good at. This is what I wanted to do. But so I decided to stay in, and then they switched me over to this other job, and he said it was a bitch and a half. He looked at me very seriously when he said it, and he gave me this impression like, and he kept looking at me, did you get it? You know, he's saying, really, things went really, really bad. He said he loved the service, but the job they put him in was hideous. Then I hit my shin later on with a board, it really hurt bad. God was showing me, look, the temptation is very strong up front, but later on, you know, you're going to be cast into disgrace and crushed. The yoga girls will crush you. The goddess will crush you because they're afraid that there might be some populist cult arising of revision. And say, wait a minute, you know, factionalism. Paranoia always is afraid of factionalism. So, you know, for a while it will seem like great, and then they'll give you some hideous job they just absolutely hate, and then they'll just, you know, crush you, get rid of you. Vicious. Paranoia is vicious. History of this world is history of paranoia, actually. So yeah, at first it might look great. So hopefully Longchenpa and Jesus or whatever, maybe Longchenpa can help in some way. Get those legitimate, those who are really, really legitimate, true messianic figures who really know the truth. Get them together somewhere and let them, you know, get over their frustrations of not being able to help out. And you know, there's a way to do that. Maybe you dress up real nice and look like you're really, you know, putting on the ritz of a messianic charisma, and you just, you know, play golf or something, and you know, you just kind of get over the hurtness of it, like, wow, I really wanted to make a difference. I really wanted to help out. I'm not being able to help out now. Oh, this really is very frustrating. Yeah, it is. It's very frustrating. So I think pragmatically there has to be a way to, you know, to dissipate this frustration. And maybe, you know, be helping one another, you know, gain a genuine recognition of abidance and just stay with it. So then later on, when buyer regret set in, which it always does with paranoia, when you're under a paranoiac system, which the reptilians, that's what it is, buyer's regret sets in fast because they start busting heads and enslaving you so badly. And you say, wait a minute, whoa. we can have no deviation from our control, you know. They've like, externalize a way to control their paranoia to an extreme extent. You can use technology to monitor everybody. And there may be like a movement to rescue people from this horrible false return, you know, to rescue them. Maybe some of the apostles, those who are genuinely charismatic, you're rescuing them from the clutches of the yoga girls, really. From the talons, you know, really. Once they get their hooks into you, you feel like there's no way out. So, it's an interesting time, to say the least, isn't it? Great assist to Chandra Sarian children. Great assist, really. This is a Dakini, a female. Okay, yeah. Genuine realization. This is not a yoga girl. It's the opposite. Great heads up. Great service to the world. Talk about genuine service. That's great service right there. Giving a heads up and helping those awaken to this situation that's going on. Immaculate service there. And they can do things in a different way than like a male teacher can. Because they're in a disguise. You don't take them as anything or something, and then they can catch you unaware, so to speak, and then just disappear. And it's like, and then you're left with this shock of awakening, reverberation, and recognition. Like, wow, like that. They don't set themselves up as some teacher, you know. If you saw a teacher going, oh, teacher, please help me, you know, teach, and you're already starting structuring stuff, but Dakinis can come about and do something that catches you by surprise, and then they're gone. Where do they go? I don't know. I turned around and she was gone, you know? It's like, wow. It's a different style. It's helpful. Of course, it's very helpful. It's a complementary style. Of course, I was taking practice swings, and you could might read it as fake swings, you know. And you might be saying, why are you practicing to be a faker? You don't need to be a faker. You're the real thing. That was her message. It's like, wow. Then I realized, yeah, I don't need to practice it. I don't need to take these fake swings. Just step up and hit the ball. It's that simple. She shocked me, really shocked me with this, her laughter at my fake practice golf swings. I was making practice golf swings. And she just laughed, and then the second time, she just absolutely just lost it, and just like peals of laughter and mirth, and like, what in the world are you doing? This is hilarious. This is like the funniest thing she's ever seen in her life. It's just utterly hilarious. What are you doing practicing? Really, she's saying, that's ridiculous. That's her message, you know. He says, you're the genuine thing. You're the real thing. Stop this idiot fakery, you know. Stop being interested in fakery. You don't need to be a fake. You don't need to serve fakery at all. And that hit me later on in the round. Oh my gosh, you know. There's no merit. We don't need merit at all. This populist idea of merit is completely bogus. What kind of merit does this bottle need to be abide in its own inherent spaciousness? It's already there. It can never leave it. What does it need merit for? Does it need merit to stay there? If it doesn't have merit, is God going to cast it out of spaciousness? That's impossible. What do we need merit for? We're already perfect. This whole merit thing is crazy. But that's what sells. That's what pop out of paranoia. It's a defense against paranoia. Because we think that we have we cast God out of out of pure spaciousness. Now God is defined as some definition, and we can label, we can shift definition, and it cast it out of, you know, what it is. It's just contrasting labels. This is what we believe, you know. It's crazy. So, Christianity would say you'd ask the great saints and all the angels to protect us. In Buddhism, you say all the bodhisattvas and all the dakinis to protect us. I think Christian equivalent would be angels. And angels can't appear. They can't appear. They can take an Armanakaya appearance, really. Divine appearance, you know, appearing here. And it can just look like someone walking down the street. You don't know. And Christians know this. Christians know very well about this aspect. Angels, they've kind of romanticized it. The yoga girls have romanticized it in such a way that it's off track. It's off track. It's an aspect of greats. The feminine tends to enjoy playing with appearances. They're quite facile with that, you know. Really, they are. They show all the style and the models, how they constantly shifting clothes and makeup and appearances. So an angel, a dakini, can appear. It's easy for them to appear in any particular guise. It's just, you know, they enjoy that, actually. It's enjoyable to them. I could tell she enjoyed that. She got there's really a big kick out of it. It's really a very wonderful guise she was wearing, incognito guise, you know. It's like, I would never think of, you know, here comes an angel. So we tend to call that quote-unquote more feminine, you know. It's not technically, it's grace is neither male nor female at all, actually, but what we call feminine and female, very good actresses. They're very good at posing, some appearance, some mood, some expression, some whatever. You're very flexible that way and fluid in that way. So the angels show up oftentimes as females. And it seems natural. You know, nobody questions a female walking down the street in some odd guise, just her fashion. Nobody question. I mean, I go out today and walk here. It's ridiculous, all the fashion. I say, St. Patrick's Day, I saw this Chinese lady all dressed up, dolled up in some, you know, overblown haute couture. What she sees is high fashion. And she's got this huge ribbon pinned in her hair, kind of all fancy hairdo, with gauze, you know. It's like a miniature hat almost with ribbons, green, you know, it's clipped on her hair. It's like, oh yeah, I'm Chinese, I'm celebrating St. Patrick's Day. I'm really into it. I was like, it's hilarious. But nobody questions that at all. You know, women could put on any guise whatsoever and nobody questions it whatsoever. Where a man is like, what the heck? Like, I wear white. So what are you doing wearing all that white for? Nobody would ever question a woman like, I'm wearing white. Well, it's my mood. It's how I feel. Oh, great. Love it. It's amazing. There's this Irishman. I said, you're Irish, right? And he says, yeah, 100%, full blown on both sides. I said, you're not wearing any green. And he goes, pfft. He says, real Irish don't wear green on St. Patrick's Day. That's an American invention, St. Patrick's Day. We don't wear green. I didn't wear green either. I'm part Irish. I didn't wear green. That hit the St. Patrick's Day. Women could look at the British, the hats they wear, the British ladies. It's ridiculous. It's so absurd. I mean, they could wear anything. These ridiculous hats, and everybody says, "Oh my dear, you look so lovely. This is so wonderful." You know, you can't have a man wearing those hats. Imagine a man wearing that hat and those clothes and everything. Everyone say, "What are you doing? Something's very odd." You know, right? You can't appear. So the angels can appear in any guise at all, but usually it's feminine. Nobody pays a second notice to them whatsoever. You could be like a Yoko Ono, look slouchy with sunglasses, and just somebody, an artistic lady, really expressing herself. Doesn't matter. Anything goes, pretty much so. So, yeah. Angel can appear in any guy, trick you, you don't even know. You don't even know it's an angel. They can sneak up on you that way and disappear easily and deliver their, inspiration, their help, their heads up. And we don't know. Angels maybe have been appearing to us our whole life, so we're not even hardly aware of it, actually. I know women like to say angels appear to them like that they're special, they're female. It has nothing to do with that. Angels appear to men just as much as they appear to women. They have no partiality whatsoever in that regard. It's just, as I said, the disguise that they have, it's easier to disguise themselves as females as it is more than men. Sunglasses, any style. I mean, women can wear any style of sunglasses they want anywhere, inside, outside, you name it. Anything. It is just amazing. Any get-up or lack of get-up whatsoever. It's just nobody says a thing. There's no sartorial laws at all anymore, really, in most of the world. Islam still has them. But pretty much women can wear anything they want to, anywhere. Especially out in public, like New York, like Berkeley, you wear nothing at all, nothing at all. Santa Monica, you wear thong bikinis, you can wear hardly nothing at all also. They're working on making nudity perfectly acceptable anywhere, actually. Just whatever you feel like, you could do, look that way. No law, no clothing laws at all. Amazing. There should be, absolutely should be. There should be, indecency should not be allowed. These ridiculous bikinis that women are wearing are so ridiculously indecent. It's absolutely immodest and indecent. There should be laws against that. There used to be, absolutely used to be laws against that. And the liberals have relaxed all the laws. They're doing the work of the devil, of the reptilians. Absolutely, they are. And it helps everybody, get more and more attracted to the body. Your body should be de-emphasized. Loose clothes. I wear white. It de-emphasizes mental activity and definitional activity. Just pure white. It gives the impression of spaciousness, pure spaciousness. Black, I wear a little black to remind ourselves that, we're still here in the world. But black is also a symbol. Also, black and white is a symbol of just a cut and dried clarity of realization. How cut and dried, how simple it is, how simple it becomes. Try to minimize the patterns of your clothing. Plain, simple. I try to wear just white with a little bit of black trim, pretty much so. That's why, the priests wear black with a white collar. This is, it's very, very simple. And they're all the same. There's no, well, but actually, though, truth be told, they always wear some, for the mass, they put some stole over there, some chaseable, or whatever you want to call it, all sorts of fancy feminine styles over their black and white priestly garb. It's only when they're, you know, not giving mass that they're not wearing some colorful robes. They wear these most ornate stuff. It's just amazing. Different, looks very feminine, like a high fashion, female high fashion. Helps bring the females to mass, for sure. But very, very seldom do I see them in just the black with the white collar, you know, doing mass. I don't even know if I can remember that, if they even do that anymore. Oh, pretty amazing, huh? If you're a world beater, you want to show the world that you're a world beater. This is the thing. You want to say, hey, you see, I'm free. I'm free of this stuff. And you want to share it with others. You want to share, you know, this is why I am free. I do not know what I am. I do not know what I am. I absolutely do not know. I cannot be defined. I'm just recognizing inherent spaciousness of all there is. That's all. Just in other words, I've stopped pretending to be insane. But with this scam that's coming up, this cosmic scam, you know, that's tricky business now, navigating this tricky business. So all thanks. I'm glad that Tibetan Buddhists have my back, the great ones. They have our backs here. It's very welcome help. They're very sophisticated. This is what I found. When it comes to all this stuff, they're very sophisticated. They've seen it all. They're not naive at all. The amount of erudition in Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, the amount of erudition he had was astonishing. The amount of transmissions and learning and the overall body of his experiencing was just astonishing. I can't even can hardly comprehend it. We don't even know how the extent of it. It was so much because I don't think all of his books have been released. His autobiography. So like Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King, he knows the insides and outsides of the whole deal of it all. You're not gonna get anything past him. So he showed up when I saw him on a beach, like Santa Monica Beach, could very well have been. And he had a lifeguard shirt on. In other words, he's here to guard our lives, guard the Dharma. Okay, so we don't lose it. For those who have it, he makes sure that we don't lose it, don't get swept away by it. That's why I called out for protection. I said, we're in big trouble here. We're in big trouble here. So boom, he showed up. He's a Dharma protector, really. Dharma means spiritual teaching, truth teaching, teaching of about truth, about realization. He's a protector of that. These Buddhists are protector. These Vajrayana Buddhists or great Tibetan Buddhists are protecting the Dharma. It's very important to them. They take it seriously, really seriously, which is great, really great. And they call upon, it's called the wrathful deities, are actually they're their protectors that scare off those who will, you know, scare off the yoga girls, so, you know, scare off those who would mess with them. They call upon these wrathful deities, which are just an expression of strong intent, you know, I will not be sidetracked by anything. Now they're aware, they're very aware of getting sidetracked. It's a plague on this planet, terrible plague. But this planet is planet paranoia. Is really the name of this planet is planet paranoia. It's run on paranoia, plain and simple. And paranoia is a terrible thing. It's active virulent fear. Okay, it's fear in its virulent form. It's not just saying, well, I'm afraid. No, it's active, virulently active in defending, you know, like that. It's terrible. What do we got here? We went up 209. That's good. So it's like people like Mike Enter and the Marines, they think, you know, I really want to protect my country, you know, this is like the most, you know, awesome force on the planet, and I really, and the basic training is so intense, and I'm going to be just this, you know, great, great soldier, you know. So you can understand how they want to get into that, and then later on you find out, I've talked to a lot of Marines, and a lot of them actually don't like it. They don't. They look back. They're very critical of it. Actually, they say it's hell. It was hell. Actually, just hell. Because they get put into this or put into that. They end up not liking it. So it's a very romantic, adventurous, macho, you know, kind of thing. Or just it's like, wow, I'm gonna be put through, really young people want to be put to this big challenge. So they do build up a lot of character and strength and all these various things. That is true, but there's a downside to it. You know, so I've heard people say it was the worst mistake I ever made in my life. Greatly regret it. So this situation coming up here in the world, this fake return, staged fake return of Jesus, whatever they stage and fake, it may seem like a very noble enterprise at the beginning, like a great challenge, you know. They say, well, you know, the ends justify the means. Got the Pope on your side, got everybody on your side, like finally the whole world is being unified. And all these people that wouldn't convert before, now they're all for it, you know. And you think, wow, I'm being so successful in converting everybody. Oh my gosh, this is like the new apostolic age. I mean, just, you know, it's like a tidal wave of just everywhere I go, people are converting. And it's like, oh yeah, you know, thank you. You're a great saint. You're converting us, all this stuff. Yes, that's very seductive stuff, spiritually seductive stuff. And this Dakini's laughing at me. How ridiculous, you know. She's just, how utterly absurd. It's like, I don't know how to take this. I didn't allow myself to take it in any particular way. I just stayed in the wow of it. And then finally the right interpretation blossomed. Boom. This is what you have to do. Is do not react to any situation with anger or backlash or anything. Just stay in the wow of it. Don't advance or retreat to any reaction when something really unnerves you like this. And then eventually the right definition, the right perspective will dawn. It's, oh yeah, wow, that was super helpful. Because these angels could be unnerving. When you come across these situations of great, it can be very unnerving, because they're attention getters. They're really hitting you hard, saying you need to wake up to this. So do not respond with anger, upset. That's why I try to always be in a good mood, positive mood. This situation may also be used politically. To take all the wind out of Trump's sails, and to make everyone feel great about Hillary Clinton, who's a big time yoga girl herself, absolutely New World Order, all the way. And she might enthusiastically endorse it, you know, and actually align herself with it, because it becomes very populist, and you know, to take all the wind out of Trump's sails, to say the least. That's why I think it may start happening in this summer. I said July 24th, it might even kick off in some way, get started in some way. just absolutely decimate that whole momentum of that whole thing, because they're terrified of Trump because he's a wild card. He might not be controllable. They love control. Clinton is absolutely controllable. She's proven it. She's like a good soldier, totally controllable. Total psychopathic liar, which is what they want. Controllable psychopathic liar. And yeah, New World Order loves that. Whereas Trump, doesn't seem like he's controllable. They hate that. They hate that. They absolutely hate it, yeah. Unpredictable, loose cannon. Don't know what he's going to do. Nobody knows for sure what he'll do, but, you know, do we really want a New World Order stooge? You know, so they may be doing it to just completely bust up his campaign, too. It's all timed that way, too. To just flatten any opposition, you know, like this. Steal the spotlight. You know, he's got the spotlight now. This will steal the spotlight entirely away from him. Jesus is back. Wow. That'll steal the evangelicals away, right? If they go for it. It will create a turmoil, steal the spotlight completely off of Trump. And that's the only thing he has going is his momentum. So it's very, you know, this is hardball politics. They play hardball. You got to understand something. The reptilians play hardball. It's not business as usual here on this planet anymore. And people say, how unfair, you know, that's dirty. Well, yeah, politics is very dirty. If they'll do anything to steal the spotlight away. Politicians are geniuses at doing this. If something comes up that they want to sweep under the rug, they'll create a crisis in some way, and the whole spotlight shifts over. The media, everybody, population falls right over here. Oh, you know, a police shot someone, some black person in a city, his policeman shot him. Oh, boom, you know, it's all over onto this now. Everyone completely forgets about what the dirty stuff the politician was up to. And so they're expert at manipulating the public. That's why politician, person of the polls, the polls, proletariat, the proletariat, the proletariat, the political body of, you know, they're into manipulating public attention. They're experts at it. So don't be surprised if real dirty pool comes up here, really dirty pool arises very soon. Oh my gosh, the Messiah is back, you know. He's walking on a beach in Santa Monica, and there's all these miracles happening. Oh my gosh, this is it. The second coming's happened, you know. Yeah. Don't be surprised in the slightest bit. So you've got a heads up about this. But they're capable of adjusting things. They are. They're politicians, very flexible, adjustable. But this is a heads up. The general outlines of how they work, how they conduct their business is being made clearer here, right? Absolutely it is. They play very dirty. With shamelessly. They have no shame or conscience whatsoever. They're just paranoia as their god. They serve that god religiously. Right? They serve that god religiously. And whatever that god says, they think this is marching orders. We'll do it. You tell us to do this, you tell us to deceive, we'll do it. Whatever. We gotta get rid of that paranoia. Yeah, they're just driven by it. They can be very charming, but underneath you feel this paranoia is there. It can snap at any moment. If you tick them off, these higher-ups in the reptilian hierarchy, you know, they may feel very powerful and charismatic, but also there's this inner feeling like there's some instability there, and if I say the wrong thing, you know, wow, off with your head. Which is what a lot of the aristocracy in the history of this planet has been quite reptilian, and there was a lot of them are that way. I mean, you rub them the wrong way, you know. The hammer comes down on you. It's really very driven by paranoia, which is drives them to have the empires and control everybody, of course. It seems like the paranoids are the ones who usually end up in power in this world. So, it's a paranoid world. World paranoia is how it should be defined. Okay, so, this is great news, great good news. We're being helped. We're being helped. And from many different angles. Many different angles. Thank God for that. Thank the Trinity for that. And all praise to the Holy Spirit for bringing this to our attention. grace of God bringing this to our attention. And that should be enough for now, right? Absolutely. All good things must come to an end, but all true things never come to an end. And there's only one truth, right? And we're it. Everything is it right now. Without anything happening at all. There's nothing that needs to happen. Everything that happens is truth. Nothing's leaving its intrinsic spaciousness. So there's nothing special that needs to happen at all, ever, ever. So that's something to consider as we end the video. All right, very great. That's it for this one.